So we're really happy to be here today. Share a few thoughts with you around CRM, around identity, and we're gonna kind of start big, kind of hone in. Hopefully there's a few things that you can take away, maybe about people, maybe about process, maybe about technology. But being at Google, I thought it might be appropriate to start with a search. I think a lot of people might think of CRM onboarding as that next step in my retargeting kind of strategy. So I have some other data that I want to activate against. So maybe this is a good place for us to start. And what I wanted to do was plot over time the interest in the US around the term retargeting. And I was actually kind of surprised to see that this is still going kind of up and to the right, right? There's maybe a little dip recently, but since 2008, the interest in retargeting has continued to grow. So what do we think the terms CRM onboarding, people-based marketing, customer match, custom audience, how do we think those might compare to everyone's interest in retargeting? I was surprised to see that it has not broken through nearly to the same degree as retargeting, right? So our market still is, let's say, comfortable with retargeting. They know what it is. Maybe sometimes they abuse it too much with too much frequency or the pair of shoes that follow you around the web. And the rest of this next wave of kind of that personalization and relevance for consumers really hasn't caught up. So this kind of notion of, you know, don't mind the gap, well, there's a couple of things. One, the rest of the market hasn't gotten there, right? So there's an opportunity for us. But if you're still not certain yourself about what this means, how it relates to you, how much could it be a part of your business, that's fine too, right? Because we've got time to kind of close that gap, if you will. So what I'd love to do is kind of break kind of this down into three parts. One, maybe taking a step back to say, why are we thinking about this in the first place? The second, what are some of those first steps you might take to make CRM or identity a core part of your business or a part of your story, a part of how you deliver results for clients? And the last bit is kind of the pivot from not just thinking about targeting, but into measurement, into analytics, into planning, the evolution of kind of the way to deliver campaigns or just communications in general on behalf of the brands that we work for. So the case for CRM onboarding. This stat always kind of blows me away, right? So this says about 9% in last quarter of US sales was e-commerce, right? So 90% of still the transactions that we're actually trying to help brands deliver, grow their businesses, 90% still happen in the physical world, right? So if you have the perfect, you know, attribution, cross-device measurement solution, you're still kind of 90% incomplete, right? So kind of point one with CRM onboarding is that marrying of the physical and the digital world, right? You begin to kind of match those transactions that happen offline with all the consumer engagement and transactions that can happen online. So kind of part one. Part two with CRM onboarding is this notion of personalization. So our friends at Accenture put together a study where they're asking consumers about their engagement with brands, both kind of online and in store. And 40% of consumers said they've actually left a website because there's too much going on. It wasn't tailored to them. They had to make too many decisions. 65% said that when the brands and the retailers I frequent show me my history or kind of show that they know me more, they then transact as well, right? And 65% again say that they're gonna kind of spend more or engage more when those messages are personal to them, whether it's email, whether it's display or video. So consumers really want their marketing to take a step up, right? And Forrester has kind of put together what I think is a pretty challenging but also great opportunity kind of mission statement, right? And I highlighted the section that I think matters the most, which is kind of tailored experiences for each user, consumer, I would probably say, with his or her specific set of circumstances. And circumstances change. It's not just simply what was the last thing I bought. It could be relevant to the time of day, the geography. So how do we begin to bring some of that together, right? That's our challenge in front of us. And the reality is, as consumers, our social feeds, our content feeds, our commerce feeds are already giving us these kind of recommendations, right? So why is marketing, in a sense, kind of lagging behind some of these platforms and delivering more relevance and engagement for me? Right. And I'd actually argue email is kind of the canary, if you will, that shows personalization delivers results. So simply by changing the subject line from "Hi there" to "Hi Chris," it's 26% more chance that I'm going to click and open it and see what that message is. Right? Experian also has a stat that says six times, if you personalize emails, it's six times more likely for people to transact with that communication. So we've already kind of maybe taken that first step with email on kind of that personalization. So again, how are we going to grow this to all forms of communication, and how do we make them work together? Right? That's kind of where we start with CRM onboarding, where it really makes sense and how we're going to deliver relevance for consumers. Okay, so I kind of mentioned maybe, you know, retargeting is the grandfather of CRM onboarding, right, from a targeting perspective. So a piece of data I know about a consumer, I'm going to deliver them a targeted message now. And I think that's, while a good first step, sometimes misses the opportunity. I'm not sure if anyone maybe in the audience knows who this is. His name's John Lasseter, and he's the co-founder of Pixar and now kind of the head creative genius at Disney. And I love using this quote from him, that it's not the technology, it's the story, right? The computer is just a tool, or technology is just there in the background in the service of the story. So a lot of times we think, well, what's the campaign I have live? I'm doing some retargeting. How could I scale this? Well, maybe some CRM onboarding. But what's that story to the consumer? What is that first piece of data that we got through that CRM file? Is the message I'm actually sharing with them in this existing campaign actually relevant for them? Right. So I always think it's smart to go back to strategy first. And you know, we've used this kind of sample, kind of brief to tie, you know, what's again my business objective at the start, to, you know, the role of communications, to creating tactics that then talk about, you know, this consumer. And it doesn't have to always be first party data; it could be third party data in these use cases. But it always goes back to what's my objective, right? What am I trying to deliver for my brand? Does it make sense actually to use CRM data in this case? Right? So I always think it's good to kind of take that step back. The next step is often organizational. Sometimes we talk a lot about how technology can bring data together. I think you also have to bring people together. Because a lot of the times when you add new data or kind of change measurement, people's jobs change at the same time. Right? You could be saying maybe paid search doesn't contribute as much as we think, and so therefore their budget's going to be reallocated somewhere else. Right? That kind of changes someone's job. It's not easy to do such a thing, especially for large brands that I'm sure many of us work with or work for. And so we have a shared client with Group M, with IBM. And our friend Jeff kind of put it into good context for us and said, you kind of start with the data, right? The data really doesn't lie. So as much as someone who has maybe that historic large budget or large influence in the organization, if the data says we need to move in a different direction, you can't argue against that. And that's a good way to bring people together, start having some of those conversations, to even kind of scenario plan together with different business units, right? IBM is unique in its sense of got 13 different business lines, right? Each having their own objectives, but often selling to the same consumer or same business professional. So bringing everyone together and kind of creating that shared process really is an important step. And process also matters kind of from the technical side as well. So I want to kind of spend a little bit of time, because often I think our market uses jargon and the notion of always thinking about scale, I think I want to dispel a little bit, right? So kind of base level, right? You've got a CRM data set. You're going to deterministically match that to a match set. And it's usually going to be less than 100%, right? Just as a matter of reality. But there are options, right? And one of the things I'd always want to focus on is kind of knowing those options, right? So your first option is basically say, now expand this to the household, right? An auto brand, knows that its purchase cycle is a little longer. It's a kind of household decision. So if I have a piece of data about one consumer, it makes sense for me to maybe expand to the household. Similarly, maybe I don't mind doing a lookalike kind of model using probabilistic, right? But I have to know that a set of those consumers that I've now expanded to aren't actually my customers. So if I ever think about doing measurement, I don't really have that relationship to tie it back. But that could, again, be an option to say, I know something and I'm gonna model off of it. But there's also modeling through other third-party data providers as well. Again, taking that seed kind of data set, CRM, on-site visits and digital information. You can expand off of that, right? But this choice, I want people to kind of think about as a conscious decision, not a, how do I have the largest, match set of data? How do I scale this audience, right? We think too much, I think, in terms of volume versus the customer relationship. And so the analogy that I've often been using is Tinder, right? And so I want to set in your minds that accuracy and precision are more important than match rate, right? So if I'm optimizing for match rate on Tinder, I'm swiping right on every single photo, right? And then let's all of a sudden say I get that match and I look and I go, oh, this actually isn't who I was looking for, right? I was trying to go for volume, and yet if I actually want to have a relationship with someone, this actually isn't the right match for me, right? So think about being selective, right? What are those key points that we're going to say this actually matches to what I'm looking for? I think really, really matters. So the other thing that we often try to articulate is we know it's not going to change dramatically day one. We're now a people-based marketing organization. Right? And again, I think this journey starts with retargeting, and that's fine. Maybe you start doing a little bit more with Google or with Facebook. You add it into your programmatic campaigns. But I want to kind of maybe articulate how you maybe pivot into planning, or how you pivot into measurement, or how you continue on the line of targeting. Right? So there's other publishers, the Spotify's, the Pinterest's, the Snapchats, that also allow you to use and leverage your customer data for campaigns and for analysis and measurement, right? And maybe once you've done some campaigns with those partners, you now want to think about using these tools for planning. So what data maybe am I getting back? What third-party data can I augment with to now change the brief that I'm going to use with my agency or use with my publisher partners? And likewise, you could start even earlier on measurement. Instead of thinking about last click or CPM-driven savings type of measurement, how do I start with maybe multi-touch? How do I bring in some maybe analytics, maybe even offline, online, incrementality as well? So the point here is that no one's journey is the same. At any point, you can incorporate these other options with planning and measurement. I'm gonna spend a little bit of time maybe on assuming people have done retargeting, worked with walled gardens, done some programmatic, some of those other opportunities that are out there. Specifically with publisher, what I'm describing is publisher direct. So we're familiar with our walled garden friends, but there's a number of publishers with direct integration for CRM data. And the matching happens with their data set. So once again, if I bring back my friend the match rate, if you're AARP and you're trying to optimize your match rate with Snapchat, you're doing something wrong at the strategy level, right? You should have likely a zero match rate. So taking a step and saying, okay, what are the unique things that these platforms offer to the audience that I'm trying to communicate with? What data can I provide them to help them either expand that audience or provide me with insights back from that audience? So I'll give you a quick case study from Target and Pinterest, where Target onboarded its whole CRM file, and then began targeting and segmenting people who had made a grocery purchase in the last 12 months, and then splitting that into people who had purchased wellness products and people who had not purchased wellness products, right? So by providing that information to Pinterest, they can not only target, but also provide measurement back, right? So now they know from this campaign, both in-store and online, that their campaign had an impact. the interesting thing in this campaign is actually it's the non-wellness. People who had not bought health products started buying health products. The people who had health products already knew, and so it didn't really impact them as much, right? But they can tell that story now. They can talk about delivering business results. And I actually was at the ANA's recently, and the CMO of HP kind of talked about this mentality of being a business person first and a marketing, he called artisan, second, right? As much as marketing can deliver results for the business, the more investment you can have and engagement you can have with that organization. But it's not just campaigns that when you're working with these publishers, there's some value. Spotify is another example where with an auto brand that they shared with me, auto brand onboarded CRM, and Spotify gave back these kind of insights and analytics about that audience. What were the types of songs that they were listening to? What kind of moods were they in at different points in the day? Some interesting stuff, especially as Spotify grows its footprint from not just on your laptop or your mobile, but into your car, into your home, you know, with Google Home and other voice assisted assistants. And likewise, kind of on the measurement side, a omnichannel retailer provided online order information, call center information, right? This rich data set that then Spotify could say, well, here are all the impressions we delivered against these audiences. You tell us what kind of impact they had on your business. So this kind of exchange of data between partners is becoming more common. It's not always just about the campaign activation in the media. There's this other opportunity that, again, can go into planning, can go into measurement. Second one I would say is search, right? So Google Customer Match is a great product that allows you to now expand some of the keywords that you might be able to buy. My background is at another agency, and I was always surprised when I kind of was first learning a lot about search of how much brands would buy their own branded keywords. And if you saw the news recently about Restoration Hardware, you know, they struggle with kind of buying those keywords. But with Customer Match and now taking data from wherever you have that consumer touch point, you now can buy those unbranded keyword terms at a much higher rate with much greater confidence because you see the results. It's really expensive to buy the term Nike shoes or yoga pants, but if I know I have that consumer who already has a relationship with me, ideally a deep relationship, that's actually a great investment for me, especially if I'm launching a new product line. So we have a client, Finish Line, that did exactly that. Took online data, took in-store data, kind of loyalty data, and not only the story here is also that with LiveRamp, we were able to enhance that data set. So they may have had a Hotmail address. We were able to append a Gmail address to kind of expand that footprint so that they were able to communicate with more of their consumers. But you see the stats on the comparison of you know, how they were now able to optimize that campaign. You know, it's night and day. So, okay. So maybe you feel a little bit more kind of knowledgeable on maybe how to get started, some different maybe paths to change, or how do you incorporate some new opportunities with CRM and targeting. But I want to pivot to identity. And the notion here is that if all I'm thinking about is simply making my data actionable, I don't necessarily care too much if that's tied back to a US individual or household. And what I want to kind of describe to you today is why that really does actually matter, why there's a huge amount of value, why when you're going back to kind of that matching process, why deterministic matters so much, is to be able to kind of end-to-end have that consumer relationship. So kind of thinking about your offline identity, what I often describe is kind of going back into your Amazon account and looking through all the different addresses that you've had. Right, and Amazon for me has college, you know, addresses. I've lived in New York, in LA, multiple places in San Francisco. I've shipped to different people. So that kind of identity of myself has changed over time, right? And so when we think about brands and having their data at some point in time, maybe they know my old address. Maybe they don't know my new address. So what we often see is a brand only having one kind of node on this spoke, right? And so at LiveRamp and Axiom, our focus and part of our job is to kind of fill in those missing gaps or update that kind of CRM data from that brand in order for it to be actionable for them. The other part of our business is kind of knowing those kind of unidentified consumer touch points across devices, right? I'm sure we all can start rattling off all the different connected TVs or devices or browsers even that we use at our home, and how our identity is extremely fragmented, right? And so how do we begin to put that together, have that knowledge of kind of the US consumer base and households, and then link them together in a privacy-centered way, right? So now I'm beginning to be able to expand the way I can not only identify, but measure and plan, and again, kind of create this omni-channel consumer relationship across digital and physical experiences. And so bear with me for this eye chart, you know, for just a few seconds. I'll create a simple version on the next slide. But if you think of lots of different data sets, right? What we're trying to do is kind of anonymize a number of different features, including PII, bring them all together into one master table, if you will, and then have all of these different data points, right? Sometimes data will be missing. Sometimes you'll have a lot of kind of columns for one individual consumer. And what I want to tell the story is specific to a brand to make it a bit more actionable for you, right? So let's say BMW is kind of working in this space. And they have some data that's kind of offline, right, of dealership visit. They've got some data that's online, putting out a test drive form. And with those two data points, they could do some analysis, but they could also append some third-party data. And in this case, we're saying we've got some location data that we're going to compare it against, some demo data, some behavioral, some transaction data with a partner like Ibotta. And you begin to round out this knowledge about this particular consumer, right? And then the additional opportunity is for the people who have not engaged with BMW. So the data they're missing, but that other partners know about, right? And again, having this common identifier allows for much deeper analysis and ultimately kind of campaign planning or measurement. So we have a number of brands that kind of had made this pivot from not just targeting, but now doing analytics. So for Legendary Motion Pictures as a movie studio, it's all about the analytics. And they're actually an interesting case because they've started to build their own algorithms on top of some DSPs to how to link this together. And Sephora is another one where innovation really matters to them. And by kind of building this picture of their consumer set in store and online, they can look like rock stars in their organization. So a few kind of closing, kind of bringing it all together thoughts before questions. Strategy first, again, taking that step back before you take your first step forward, I think matters a lot. When you're working with technology, it's not just about bringing everything together, it's about bringing people together as well. Know that process, kind of that matching process. What are those trade-offs? In what cases does it make sense to use one or another? And the last, try to go beyond just targeting with CRM and identity. Try to bring in some planning, bring in some measurement. And with that, I'd say thank you very much for, again, having us. And I'm happy to take any questions.